Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents 1964, the greatest year in the history of Japan. How the Tokyo Olympics symbolized Japan's miraculous rise from the ashes. By Roy Tomizawa. Narrated by David Shih. Preface. On the opening day of the 1964 Tokyo Olympics, October 10, 1964, I turned one. My father, Thomas Tomizawa, was in Tokyo working with the NBC News crew that broadcasted the 18th Tokyo Olympiad to homes in the United States. I still treasure the various souvenirs he brought back from Asia's first Olympiad. As a teenager, I proudly wore my 1980 NBC Moscow Olympic t-shirt, likely the only kid in Queens, New York to have one. I have been a fan of the Olympics for a long time. When I moved to Japan for a third time in 2014, a year after Tokyo was awarded the right to host the 2020 Games, I went to the Japanese bookstore, Kinokuniya, in search of a book in English on the 1964 Tokyo Olympics. None were in print. So, I decided to write that book. A former journalist myself, I began my research in late 2014, copying all that I could in the National Diet Library. At the beginning of January 2015, I interviewed American gymnast Makoto Sakamoto, the first of over 70 Olympians from 16 different nations who participated in those 1964 Summer Games. Many of the quotes in this book are directly from those Olympians. On May 1, 2015, I launched my blog, The Olympians, at theolympians.co. For over 1,000 straight days, I obsessively published an original blog post on anything related to the 1964 Tokyo Olympics, the Olympics, Japan, and sport in general. The blog, in essence, became my first draft for this book. The book, in essence, became my weekend meditation and an expression of my deep appreciation for Japan and a fascination for Japan's biggest post-war movement. Introduction. The Happy Games in the Eye of the Storm. In 1964, Japan was getting ready for the biggest party in the world, the Summer Olympics. Olympic officials were working around the clock to manage Japan's most complex peacetime event ever. Japanese athletes were steeling themselves to compete against world-class performers. Engineers and construction firms were rushing to complete massive plans for highways and railways, stadiums and hotels. Government officials and teachers were educating the public on how to best present themselves to the tens of thousands of foreigners that would pour into Japan. Police were taking pickpockets off the streets and ensuring bars in Tokyo were complying with directives to close down early. The Japan Self-Defense Forces were preparing for their supporting roles in various events such as sailing and rowing. In fact, every man, woman, and child in Japan was getting ready to welcome the world to their country, many believing it was their civic duty to ensure that foreigners who came to town were not deprived of any necessity or assistance. A resident of Shibuya remembers as a child that the ward office instructed all Japanese to convert the toilets in their homes, essentially holes in the ground, to flush toilets, on the off chance that a foreigner might visit them. So the man's mother took out a loan and made the change. His father, who worked for the railways, began to study English at his own expense on the slight possibility that he might have to guide a foreigner to the right place. Everyone, it seemed, was catching Olympic fever. Even his neighbor. In the summer of 1964, we had less rain. When I sprinkled water on the street in front of my house, a neighbor got angry with me, saying, "Save water for the foreigners," as if he regarded me as an unpatriotic man. The Japanese were determined to show the world that they could host the Summer Olympic Games, the first in Asia, and regain the world's trust after the upheaval of the Second World War. Nothing could distract them from this mission, not even the clamor of geopolitical conflict and social change taking place in and around the 2 weeks of the Tokyo Olympics, October 10th to 24th. And there were lots of distractions. Only 2 months before the start of the Olympics, on August 4th, a battle between U.S. and North Vietnamese military boats was said to have taken place in the Gulf of Tonkin, with a second attack said to have taken place 2 days later. In consequence, the U.S. Congress passed a resolution which, in effect, justified the deployment of U.S. conventional forces in Vietnam to defend against communist aggression. On September 24th, only 10 months removed from the assassination of American President John F. Kennedy, the Warren Commission, headed by Supreme Court Chief Justice Earl Warren, presented its 888-page report to President Lyndon B. Johnson with the hopes of diffusing the growing rumors of widespread conspiracy. On October 3rd, only a week prior to the start of the Tokyo Olympics, 57 East Berliners nervously walked through a tunnel dug under the Berlin Wall to escape to freedom in West Berlin. On the third day of the 1964 Tokyo Olympics, October 12th, the Soviets took the world by surprise, launching the first three-man spaceship in history into orbit. The Voskhod circled the Earth 15 times, raising the rhetoric on which superpower was winning the space race. On October 14th, the fifth day of the Tokyo Olympiad, one of the most powerful men in the world, USSR First Secretary Nikita Khrushchev, was deposed from power by his own Communist Party, news that stunned the world. That same day, it was announced that Martin Luther King Jr. had won the Nobel Peace Prize. 2 days later, the People's Republic of China detonated an atomic test bomb, sparking fears of atomic fallout over Japan, the only nation to have suffered nuclear attack. It is incredible to think that so much of global significance happened that autumn of 1964, particularly during those 2 weeks of the Tokyo Olympiad. And yet, it seems relatively few were tuned into the raucous geopolitical noise of the time. When informed afterwards, many of the participating athletes were surprised to hear so much was happening in the world around them. In retrospect, they realized they were deep in their cocoon of concentration. But so were the people of Japan. Only 19 years after the physical and moral devastation of defeat at the end of World War II, after the humiliation of foreign rule into the early 1950s, Japan's attention was wholly focused on hosting an Olympics that would stand out in the annals of the event. It is, of course, hyperbole to call any year the greatest year in a country's history, as is the case in this book's title. But one can argue that the 18th Olympiad, held in Tokyo, Japan in October 1964, has become a symbol of the immense collective joy of the time, a cathartic release from the psychological purgatory of defeat in the Pacific War, subjugation by the enemy, and the painstaking recovery from destitution and despair. Never was the nation more aligned. Never was the nation prouder than in 1964, rising from the rubble to embark on the greatest Asian economic miracle of the 20th century. The only thought most Japanese had in October 1964 was to convince the world that Japan was peaceful, friendly, productive, innovative, and modern, that they belonged to the global community as much as any other nation. It is perhaps a measure of their success that despite all the surrounding turmoil, the games they produced came to be known as the Happy Olympics. Chapter 1. A Feeling of Doom. A Dutch judoka defeats a Japanese at his own game. The Dutch Giant. It was Friday, October 23rd, 1964, the penultimate day of competition. The Nippon Budokan was charged with excitement. Paul Maruyama of the United States judo team watched from the side as two giants of judo stepped up on the tatami-matted platform to face off in the finals of the open weight division. Anton Heysink of Holland and Akio Kaminaga of Japan. Judo was debuting at the Olympics, the only event native to Japan, and the Japanese had already taken gold in the first three weight classes over the previous 3 days. Maruyama understood that this was no ordinary match, that to sweep the judo championship in all four weight classes would set off celebrations across Japan and bring back feelings of pride that had been crushed at the end of World War II, a mere 19 years prior. "It was definitely an electric atmosphere," said Maruyama. "The Budokan was packed. The crown prince and princess were present, but there was also a sense of resignation in the air. The spectators could see for themselves. Haysink was 2 meters tall and weighed 120 kilos, this big foreign guy, while Kaminaga was 1.8 meters tall and only 102 kilos. In fact, Haysink had already shocked the judo world in 1961 by becoming the first non-Japanese to win the world championships, defeating the Japanese champion, Koji Sone. So while the Japanese in the Budokan were hoping Kaminaga would exceed expectations, hope was all they had. Japanese novelist Tsuneo Tomita was in the Budokan that day. He saw Haysink and Kaminaga go up against one another in a preliminary round and felt that Kaminaga had lost before the match had even begun. "Haysink stood tall," he wrote, "raising both hands high in the air, readying himself for the battle, total confidence in his expression. On the other hand, Kaminaga's face was pale and his entire body rigid. This does not look good," I thought with a gulp. Haysink then handled Kaminaga quite easily in that preliminary match. What could be done? If Kaminaga was to face Haysink again in the medal round, a likely scenario, could he find a weakness in Haysink's formidable technique? Maruyama's teammate, exchange student Ben Nighthorse Campbell, was also a member of Kaminaga's team at Meiji University, a judo powerhouse in Japan at the time. According to Campbell, they gathered together behind locked doors to come up with ways to take Haysink down. Kaminaga then engaged in practice bouts with fellow Meiji judoka, who mimicked Haysink's style and technique, looking for that nugget of insight that would give Kaminaga a fighting chance. During the course of the day's tournament, both men progressed through qualifying matches. Kaminaga won his bouts, but Haysink dominated his. Tomita described Haysink's matches as akin to a sole black belt tossing around a bunch of white belt novices. Judo purists in Japan at the time believed that height and weight were less important than balance, technique, and attitude, which is why judo competitions in Japan at that time never segregated judoka into weight classes. But weight and size can make a significant difference if all other factors are equal. In those days, there was still an attitude that skill could prevail over size and weight, said Campbell, who would go on to become a 2-term U.S. senator for Colorado. Over time, judo has changed. Size matters. The Japanese saw themselves as smaller and weaker when compared to the West. They saw the face-off between Haysink and Kaminaga as a reminder of the Pacific War, when the bigger, stronger Americans, with their bigger, stronger military weaponry, ended the war with authority. And the Japanese public still remembered Douglas MacArthur, the conquering American general who ruled over Japan from 1945 to 1951. Often seen with sunglasses and a pipe, the tall man was a towering presence who commanded respect and fear, even as he earned genuine gratitude for the benevolent aspects of his tenure. As the head of the Allied powers in Japan, MacArthur got badly needed food and medicine to people across the country from the start. He leveled the local playing field with his economic policies and actions, in particular by purchasing land, by fiat, from the small number of large landowners and reselling them to the tenant farmers who worked the land. And he engineered a peaceful transition from foreign rule to Japanese government. But quite suddenly, on April 11, 1951, President Harry Truman ordered MacArthur home, ending his command of the United Nations forces in Korea, including his command over occupied Japan. Nearly a month later, at the end of a series of congressional hearings, and after many complimentary words about the Japanese and their resilience, he made an unexpected comment that struck a nerve in the Japanese psyche. According to historian John Dower, in his book, Embracing Defeat, Japan in the Wake of World War II, MacArthur compared Germany to Japan, arguing that Germany had no excuse for being the aggressor in Europe, but that Japan was a different case and that we needed to give the Japanese the benefit of the doubt, despite their actions in World War II. He went on to say, if the Anglo-Saxon was, say, 45 years of age in his development, in the sciences, the arts, divinity, culture, the Germans were quite as mature. The Japanese, however, in spite of their antiquity measured by time, were in a very tuitionary condition. Measured by the standards of modern civilization, Japan would be like a boy of 12 as compared with the Anglo-Saxon development of 45 years. At the time, that comment was a bracing slap that no doubt added motivation to Japanese efforts at recovery. By 1964, that recovery had progressed so far that Japan was able to put on an Olympiad unparalleled for its efficiency, hospitality, and technological precision, laying its claim to equal stature in the international community with the Western powers. But as the Japanese watched Heisink get ready to grapple with Kaminaga in front of the defeated emperor's eldest son, some may have recalled MacArthur's remark, or yielded to the foreboding that the larger Westerner would inevitably prove superior. The referee motioned for the commencement of the match. Maruyama saw the intimidation start early. Heisink was a big guy, but when he raised his arms high, he looked huge. I think he did it so that his sleeves would slide down his arms and provide less area for his opponent to grab. But I think his opponents thought that it just made this big guy look bigger. Of course, you can't compare the ravages of war to the outcome of a judo match, he went on to say. But to many looking on, there had to have been echoes of that awful empty feeling that pervaded the country after its defeat in 1945. For at the end of the war, only 19 years prior, Japanese were indeed in desperate straits, both in Japan as well as its former colonies across the Sea of Japan. Paul Maruyama knows exactly how desperate those times were. He was there. Where's Paul? I was 5 years old, and I was on a train in Manchuria with my three brothers and my parents, Maruyama recalled. With a few other kids on the train, we paraded up and down the aisles without a care in the world. There were a lot of bigger men sitting in the train car with us, and they would pick us up, and we would play with their mustaches and touch their weapons. They were Soviet soldiers, and I'm sure my parents were very nervous. But we just played and played. The Maruyamas were on the run, seeking a safe haven in a city in China called Dalian. It was autumn 1945. Japan had already surrendered to the U.S. and the Allied powers on August 15, 1945, and the Soviet Union had hastily declared war on Japan and overrun the Imperial Empire in Manchuria. Soviet soldiers were routinely ousting Japanese from their homes, taking possessions from them on the streets, and forcibly putting them to work to break down the Japanese industrial infrastructure so that machinery and scrap metal could be sent back to the Soviet Union. Even worse, Japanese women were harassed or raped, while Japanese men were sent to work in camps in Siberia. The estimated 1.7 million Japanese pioneers, bureaucrats, and civilians, not including the thousands of Japanese imperial soldiers and their dependents, who moved to Manchuria in the 1930s and 1940s to start new lives, were left to fend for their very lives when the Pacific War ended. Paul Maruyama's father, Kunio Maruyama, moved to Manchuria as it was a place of opportunity for adventurous Japanese. And as it would turn out, he would go on to play a role of epic proportions in repatriating this population, as his son Paul would describe in his book, Escape from Manchuria. After the war, millions of Japanese soldiers and civilians were scattered across Asia, including Manchuria, a part of China which the Japanese had colonized in 1933. In the aftermath of the Pacific War, when communist and nationalist forces fought for control of China, and when Soviet forces attempted to carve out their own part of northern China, the Japanese were caught between a rock and a hard place, kicked out of their homes by the Soviets and despised by the Chinese who had suffered under their rule, their bank accounts frozen, their possessions stolen, their hopes of survival slim. Kunio Maruyama assumed that authorities in Japan would be preoccupied with the changes brought in by the occupation, and that ultimately, he would have to find a way to convince MacArthur to send U.S. ships to repatriate the Japanese. How he would get to Japan, let alone meet General MacArthur. He had no idea. First, he needed help. The 37-year-old Maruyama sought the advice of his company's president and was advised to partner with a 31-year-old head of an architectural firm, Hachiro Shinpo. The two agreed that GHQ in Japan needed to know of the abandoned Japanese in Manchuria. Shinpo then introduced a member of his firm, 24-year-old Masamichi Musashi, to join in this effort. But first, they had to get to Japan. At great risk to their lives, masquerading as Chinese, the three sneaked their way through war zones occupied by the Soviets and Communist Chinese, and were finally able to negotiate with the Nationalist Chinese to allow them safe passage to Japan so they could begin their campaign to repatriate the Japanese in Manchuria. Despite the tremendous risk of being caught or killed on the way out of China, and the challenge of three unknown Japanese having to figure out a way to navigate the newly established governing structure in Japan, the men were incredibly effective. They first met in Anshan on October 15, 1945, to sketch out a plan to bring back their countrymen from China. They successfully escaped from China on March 9, 1946, carrying letters from the head of the chairman of the All Manchuria Japanese Association, an American bishop who headed Manchuria's Catholic Church in Dalian, as well as from Kuomintang officials who vouched for their mission and helped open doors in Japan. And after a few weeks of publicizing their situation through the press and meeting with Japanese government officials, the three were able to secure a meeting with General MacArthur on April 5th. Only 5 weeks later, on May 14, 1946, the first ship transported 1,219 Japanese back from China to Kyushu. By the time the last ship from China docked in Sasebo, Kyushu, on April 3, 1948, nearly 1.5 million Japanese civilians were brought home from Manchuria. Thanks to Maruyama, Shinpo, and Musashi, a generation of families and their progeny were saved and allowed to take part in the revival and economic miracle of Japan. The greatest growth in Japan's population was during the 1950s, at 15.6%. The Japanese repatriated from Manchuria and their children helped contribute to that population explosion. But things could have turned out quite differently that day when the Maruyamas were on the train to Shenyang, the children playing innocently with the Soviet soldiers. When the Maruyamas, the Shinpos, and the then single Musashi got off the train, Paul's mother, Mary, had the worst of revelations. "Where's Paul?" she shouted. Their 5-year-old was missing. The dread was evident on all their faces. What could have happened? Happily, just before the incident boiled over into full-blown crisis, Paul was hoisted out of a train window, falling into the arms of his relieved parents. It did not occur to them until afterwards that their mission to find safe passage for the three men to Japan could have ended then and there. Paul, with his three brothers and mother, Mary, would return to Japan and reunite with his father, Kunio Maruyama, on January 10, 1947, spending the prior 10 months hidden under the protection of the Catholic Church in Dalian. Paul would eventually move to the United States after graduating from a U.S. military dependents high school in Japan, become a judoka at the American Judo Powerhouse of San Jose State University, represent the U.S. at the debut of judo at the 1964 Tokyo Olympics, and coach subsequent judo teams for Team USA. Millions of Japanese returned to their homeland after being abandoned throughout Asia. And while they were relieved to come home, what they found was a battered and demoralized Japan. Devastated Japan. Maruyama, Shinpo, and Musashi's efforts saved many lives, but the Pacific War still decimated a generation of Japan's youth. Estimates of deaths during the war range from 2.5 to 3.1 million, the majority of which were young men of the Japanese military. Civilians were not spared, as 550,000 to 800,000 living in Japan and countries throughout Asia died. In his book, Embracing Defeat, John Dower wrote of the utter destruction to Japan's physical landscape, its industrial infrastructure, and its people. According to Dower, 80% of all ships, 33% of all industrial machine tools, and 25% of all motor vehicles and trains in Japan were destroyed. He also wrote that 66 major cities in Japan were bombed by American planes, on average destroying 40% of those geographies and leaving 30% of their populations without homes. The three largest cities were rendered wastelands, with the homeless rates at 89% for Nagoya, 57% for Osaka, and 65% for Tokyo. The end of the war did not bring joy, only momentary relief, as the vast majority of Japanese citizens entered a new phase of open competition for food and security. Any elation over the repatriation of 5 million countrymen was quickly overwhelmed by feelings of shame and frustration. MacArthur's Japan, an early first-hand account of those days written by AP journalist Russell Brines, describes a Japan unrecognizable today. It includes this portrayal of the repatriation of Japanese soldiers and civilians from abroad. Men, women, and children, tired and dirty, plodded off the ship, wound past the American sentry and pushed up a hill toward a weather-beaten building. They stood like cattle while doctors deloused them, then walked to the railway station. As they waited for trains, gloomy and apprehensive, commuters eyed them stiffly before hurrying away. Only relatives gave them a smile or a soft word. They soon learned the rest of Japan was too busy, or just unconcerned, to give much thought to the cycle of fate that had deposited them like rubbish on their nation's doorstep. Jammed, filthy trains took them to all parts of the homeland. Some had been away as long as 8 years. They returned to blousy cities, tiny villages, or drab farms, to the narrow contained life they had left for conquest. Many found stony neighbors, silently condemning them for sharing in defeat or for failing to die, as custom decreed. Others encountered resentment from people miserly over food and patched clothing. Some located only ashes where their homes had been, and only vagueness when they searched for missing relatives. The sifting of lives continued, day by day, behind paper-curtained little homes. Men returned to find their widows remarried. Some wives had become streetwalkers through necessity or restlessness. Women had lost some of their obedience and most of their patience. The fabric of prearranged loveless marriages was too weak in many cases to survive long separation and irritable reconciliation. For the first time, women became complainants in divorce suits, including one whose husband brought back a native wife and two children from Borneo. Jobs were scarce, money useless, and the new life confusing. Those who returned swaggering found no one willing to cringe before them, as had subject peoples. Those who came back ashamed and penitent found no pity. Only the opportunists profited, the men who had kept their eyes open to all the sharp practices they saw abroad. Dower referred to this post-war malaise as kyodatsu, a Japanese word for the collective depression that fell on the country. After all, when the emperor got on the radio on August 15, 1945, to announce that the war had ended, they had not only heard the voice of a divine being for the first time, after years of being told of the need to fight to the end, they were suddenly told to stop the resistance and to go on living and work toward Japan's recovery. The immediate meaning of liberation for most Japanese was not political, but psychological. Surrender, and by association, the Allied victory, the American army of occupation itself, liberated them from death. Month after month, they had prepared for the worst. Then, abruptly, the tension was broken. In an almost literal sense, they were given back their lives. Shock, bordering on stupefaction, was a normal response to the emperor's announcement, usually followed quickly by an overwhelming sense of relief. But that sense of relief all too often proved ephemeral. The late 1940s was a very difficult period for the Japanese. They had lost their family members, their homes, and to a great extent, their identities. They were in need of the basics to survive: food, shelter, and medicine. And they had no assurances about the future. Will Japan recover? Will my family survive? And yet, by the very existence of an Olympic Games in Tokyo, Japan had answered all those questions resoundingly. This was a hopeful Japan, welcoming the world to its shores and willing its national heroes to great achievement. But could they will Kaminaga to victory? The inevitable. For much of the match, the two judoka maintained strong grips on one another, Kaminaga's uniform already peeled open to the waist, and Heisink streaming sweat down his face and neck. Both made attempts early on to find the leverage to flip or take down the other, but for the most part, the two stood upright as the clock ticked. As he explained to reporters after the match, Heisink had decided to change tactics. In previous bouts, he came out more aggressively, looking to win early. But in the finals, I changed my plan. In the first 5 or 6 minutes, I would just try to get a reserve, just get ahead on points. Then Kaminaga would be forced to attack, and I would have the advantage. As the clock approached 10 minutes, Kaminaga went.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.